Gender is a construct. Womanhood is expansive. Womanhood is expansive. Gender is fake. Hi, my name is Pam, and I believe in expanding our definitions of womanhood and that gender is not a binary. March is Women's History Month, and much like any other month that celebrates a specific marginalized community, of course, there are just so many stories that we can't really just fit into a single month. That being said, I am someone who mostly reads work, I think majority by cis women. So I wanted to make sure that I carved out time during this month to intentionally read works by trans and non-binary writers. It was really hard for me to figure out which books I wanted to read and how many, but after a lot and a lot of Googling and just being realistic with myself, I figured that 5 was a good number and that the following 5 books would be a great mixture of genres that I'm very comfortable with reading or subject matters that I'm very into already, as well as some work that I aspire to be reading more of. So just wanted to give that disclaimer in case you're wondering how I came upon these 5 specific books. The first book on my list is Detransition Baby by Tori Peters. This is a book that I'm currently reading and follows Reese, who is a trans woman who almost had it all. She was in a very wonderful lesbian relationship where they had an apartment in Prospect Park and a job that she didn't hate. Essentially, she had scrapped together a life that many trans women dream of, a life of mundane bourgeois comforts. The only thing that was missing in her life was a child. And unfortunately for her, when her partner, Amy, decides to detransition, all of that comes crashing down. And when we start the novel, we find Reese in a series of self-destructive relationships with married men. And we also follow Reese's ex, who detransitioned and now goes by the name of Ames and lives as a cis man. And unfortunately, Ames is not happier post-detransitioning. He thought that life would be a lot easier, but it's not the case. Ending his relationship with Reese really cost him the only family that he had. And now when his boss and lover gets pregnant, he has the idea of giving Reese the one thing that she has always wanted. So this story really follows the question if these three people, Reese, Ames, and Ames's boss, Katrina, can form an unlikely and unconventional family in order to raise this child. So I started reading this book a couple of days ago from the library, and so far I really love the writing style. The writing goes by very quickly, and the characters are definitely very endearing. The main perspectives are really just from Ames and Reese, and both of them have a kind of dark sense of humor and are not shy in really illustrating the unique family dynamics within the trans community. One of the goals that Peters had was actually really blowing open all the dark corners within the trans community, such as detransitioning. In a profile on them.us by Heron Walker, Peters actually cites Imogen Binney's Nevada as a form of inspiration for this novel. Nevada is what happens when trans women are able to talk to each other, Tori said. No single person is going to have that level of insight on their own. Trans women are fucked up and flawed, and I'm very interested in the ways in which trans women are fucked up and flawed. So when I read this, I thought it was a very interesting take and kind of driving force for writing her novel. And so that's what really drove me to talk about it. I also appreciated the fact that Peters brings up the challenges within the publishing industry in her interviews, specifically the fact that in addition to the hurdle that white trans women have to go through, women of color within the trans community have even more trouble getting published and recognized at all. So the next book on my list is Nevada by Imogen Binney, which I just referenced when talking about the Transition Baby. So Imogen Binney actually wrote a monthly column for Maximum Rock and Roll, which is this really awesome badass punk zine. And that's what really drew me initially towards wanting to read Nevada. In addition to the fact that it's been on almost every single list I found online about books you need to read by trans women. She's also actually a TV writer, which I think will be very interesting when it comes to reading her novel to see if that kind of style translates. And in terms of her influences, she names Kathy Acker, Dennis Cooper, Juno Diaz, Sybil Lamb, and Michelle T. She also has a podcast where she watches classic movies, and you can find all of this on her website. So this book is a dark comedy that follows the life of a woman by the name of Maria Griffiths, who is a young punk trans woman living in New York, trying to stay true to her values and also working a retail job. So when she finds out that her girlfriend has lied side to her, she slowly sees her world begin to unravel. And so Maria sets out on a journey that will change her life forever. So as I mentioned, this book popped up in every single online list that I could find of books written by trans women. And I will say that on Binny's website, you can actually find the book available for free because of the fact that so many people want this story to be read by as many people as possible, which I think is really awesome. The basic summary of the book doesn't really give away too much, so I'm really going into this kind of blind. But I will say that the fact that this story deals with the aftermath of a betrayal will always hit home for me as someone who has dealt with that kind of experience in the past. And as I mentioned, I'm just really excited to see how Binny's experience as a TV writer will impact her writing style in this novel. I'm just confident that this is a book that will pull on my heartstrings. So the next book is a little bit away from the literary fiction genre, and it is Dreadnought by April Daniels. This is a superhero story and is the first of a trilogy by Daniels, and I believe the second book is out and we're still waiting on the third. So the story follows a teenage girl by the name of Danny who witnesses the renowned superhero Dreadnought fall from the sky and die in front of her after being murdered by the supervillain cyborg Utopia. In his final moments, he gives Danny his superpowers. These superpowers end up affirming Danny's body to her gender, and although this should be the happiest time of her life, she finds that things are as confusing as ever. Her father becomes obsessed with curing her girlhood, her best friend suddenly feels entitled to be dating her, and other superheroes in the community are trying to figure out where she stands amongst their ranks. And of course, with Utopia still running amok in the city, Danny is forced to reckon all of this at lightning speed in order to save humanity from the disaster that Utopia is bringing forth. All with the added confusion of coming out, being a teenage girl, and mastering her new powers. So I'm super excited for this book. I am someone who is MCU trash, so I saw this and knew that I would enjoy this. Danny struggles after gaining her new body and her superpowers. Just seems like a really great setup for a compelling coming-of-age story. I'm also just really excited to see the way the character Utopia is gonna be as a villain, just because with a name like Utopia, I'm assuming that there's some type of self-righteous superhero and fighting against a teenage girl who's dealing with hormones in that process just seems like a recipe for some very fun and entertaining reading. So the next book I'm reading is Fierce Femmes and Notorious Liars, a trans girl's confabulous memoir by Kai Cheng Tom. Kai Cheng Tom is a Canadian writer, performance artist, social worker, and just a fierce trans femme and notorious liar who loves lipstick and superhero cartoons. All up my alley personally. She is also a mental health community advocate, and this novel, Fierce Femmes and Notorious Liars, is her first novel. So a bit about this book, this is a highly sensational, ultra exciting, true, mostly coming of age story, and follows a young Asian trans girl, kung fu master, and pathological liar by the name of Dear Lee, who runs away from her abusive home in the town called Gloom. Striking off on her own, she ends up finding her family amidst a group of larger-than-life trans femmes who all live in a mysterious pleasure district only known as the Street of Miracles. Under the guidance of these amazing women, Dearly begins to blossom into the woman that she has always dreamed of being, particularly with the guidance of the unscrupulous Dr. Crocodile. When one of their family members is brutally murdered, Dearly teams up with her sisters and form a vigilante gang to fight back against the transphobes, violent Johns, and cops that stalk the Street of Miracles. But when things go terribly wrong, she must find the truth within herself in order to stop the violence and discover what it really means to be part of a family. So first of all, the cover of this book is absolutely gorgeous, and I can't lie that that's what really drew me in initially. Just the fact that there are all these really pretty pastel pinks and purples, as well as little images throughout the cover, just really drew me in immediately. And the fact that, you know, Kai Cheng Tom is an Asian woman. So I'm all about supporting my fellow Asian folks. But beyond the cover of the book, I just find the summary of this book to be just very whimsical and fantastical. And I'm really interested in seeing this wonderful mix of part memoir, part magical realism, and part superhero vibes in the vigilante gang that the woman in this family form. And I'm just really looking forward to the pointed focus that this novel has on sisterhood and chosen family. So the last book on my list is An Unkindness of Ghosts by Rivers Solomon, who is a non-binary writer that goes by fae, fair, or they, them pronouns. As someone who is a lover of science fiction and Afrofuturism, when I found out that Solomon cited Octavia Butler as one of their inspirations and influences, I knew that I had to read this book. Additionally, specifically for this book, Amar El-Matar, who wrote This Is How You Lose a Time War, had this to say about An Unkindness of Ghosts. She said, "Reading it, I felt it carving out a vastness inside me, pouring itself into me like so many stars. And the more I read, the bigger I felt, falling down a rabbit hole of sky and wanting only to go deeper and farther every page." And I don't know about you, but that is a very compelling review in my opinion. I'm just so ready for a vastness to be carved into my body, and also to see how Solomon uses spaceships as a backdrop for conversations on queerness, gender, and racism. So back to the summary of this book. So Unkindness of Ghosts follows an odd-mannered, obsessive, withdrawn botanist and healer by the name of Aster Gray, who has little to offer to folks in rebuttal when they call her ogre and freak. She's used to these names, but she only wishes that there were some form of truth within them. Because if she were truly a monster, she would be able to tear down the walls within the HSS Matilda, the generation ship that is currently ferrying the last of humanity to this promised land. So when a series of blackouts threatens the Matilda's voyage, as well as the lonely life that Aster has carved out for herself in the slum decks of the ship, she becomes embroiled with conflict with an overseer who is obsessed with bringing Aster to her heel. Through this, Aster may have found a way to better the experiences of those living in the slum decks like her, but only if she is willing to take him on and sow the seeds of civil war. This book sounds really cool. It gives me like Snowpiercer vibes, even though I've never watched Snowpiercer, the movie or the TV show. But you know, I think there's a lot of significance when it comes to bodies, specifically black bodies on ships and the legacy of slave trade within that. I'm curious to see how Solomon addresses this or doesn't, and also just how this will look in terms of battling on a ship in the middle of space. Like, is it gonna be like laser fighting? Is it just gonna be like, I'm curious to see how based in reality this ship is, and what exactly brought humanity to the point where the last of all humankind can fit on a generational ship. I also wanted to throw out that Solomon's newest book, Sorrowland, is actually coming out this month on March 11th, which has been dubbed as a genre-bending work of gothic fiction, which also sounds really good to me. So maybe I need to add that to my list too. So those are the five books that I'll be reading in celebration of Women's History Month. I'll definitely be sure to leave the different links to the Goodreads profiles for all these books below, as well as where you can read these books for free in regards to Nevada by Imogen Beanie. Please let me know in the comments below what books you're reading for Women's History Month. I hope you're all having a wonderful day, and I'll see you soon. Bye.